In this video, we're going to talk about the blues. So you need the assignment open on my MCPS classroom that is called the blues questions. So go ahead and get that open so you can be answering those questions while we are talking about the blues. I'll give you a moment to make sure that is open on your computer. So let's think about the blues for a second here. This is a genre of music that you may not have fully listened to before. So I want you to think about first, what do you think you already know about the blues? What comes to mind when you hear the phrase, the blues? What types of characteristics come to mind when you hear the phrase, the blues? What kind of music do you think about? What kind of singers and musicians do you think about? What instruments do you think about? When you hear the phrase the blues, what do you connect with that name, with the genre, the blues? Because even if it's not something you necessarily listen to, you probably have some ideas that are already connected to the name. So let's talk about where it came from. The blues... Initially, the genre came from what's called secular folk music. And the word secular, in case you've never heard it before, just means non-religious. So a lot of folk music was religious, and blues specifically comes from non-religious, so secular folk music. And it was created or developed by African Americans in the United States in the early 20th century, so the early 1900s. And by the 1960s, it had become one of the most important influences on pop music in the United States. So it was very popular by the 1960s, or at least any songs that were super popular in the 1960s, like clearly had blues influence if they weren't necessarily like specifically full blues themselves. So your first question on your The Blues questions assignment says, when did the blues develop? So we've just answered that. And question number two says, what group is credited with developing the blues? We've just answered that as well. So I'll give you a moment to answer those two questions. When did the blues develop would be the early 20th century. What group is credited with developing the blues would be African Americans in the United States. I'll give you another second to type in your answers to number one and number two. And I'm going to play you a few common examples of the blues that we think about from that time period, from kind of like early to mid 1900s. And I just want to see if you recognize these songs, because these are some of the most famous songs that definitely fall into the blues category. And you could argue that they're also rock and roll, but the blues and rock and roll are very closely related. So these are great examples of the blues in the way that we talk about the blues. So here's the first one. See if you recognize this. So I won't play you the whole song, but I did just want to see if you recognize any part of that one first. And this is going to be part of your answer to number three. It just says, name one example of a blues song we listened to. That first one that I just played is called Johnny B. Goode, and it's by an artist named Chuck Berry. So If you have not heard that one before, no big deal, but I was just curious. And again, the name of that is Johnny B. Good, like the letter B, Johnny, letter B, period, Good, G-O-O-D-E. And then the name of the artist is Chuck Berry. The next example I want to play for you is just another one that's kind of blues, kind of rock and roll. It's like influence by both kind of a thing. And I want to see if you recognize this one as well. So hopefully you've heard that one before. The title of that song is I Got You, parentheses, I Feel Good, and it's by James Brown. And that one's pretty famous as well. And again, it definitely falls into the blues category, but also we would probably consider that rock and roll and has characteristics of both. And again, the title of that is I Got You, parentheses, I Feel Good. The artist is James Brown. And then the last example I want to play for you is an example of the blues you've also probably heard before, and I'm not going to tell you anything about it. I just want to see if you've heard this one before, too. You ain't nothing but a So hopefully you've heard that song before. That one is called Hound Dog, and this performance, this version of this, is sung by Elvis Presley. And again, the name of that song is Hound Dog. The artist is Elvis Presley. So you should have an answer now for number three. Name one example of a blues song we listen to. And that one as well has all the blues characteristics that we talk about, and we'll go through those a little bit later. And it definitely also falls into the rock and roll category. They're just very closely related. And Elvis was also known as the king of rock and roll, which we'll kind of talk about. So that's we'll definitely put that song in both categories, the blues and rock and roll. But so those are just a few examples of songs that are in the blues genre that you may have already heard before. And we're going to talk a little bit more about the history of the blues and where this genre comes from. So the genre developed in the United States after the Civil War, which was, as we know, 1861 to 1865. And it takes some of its characteristics from West African music. And it takes some of its characteristics actually from white European musical genres. So one of those would be actually the 12-bar form, which we'll talk about as well. And the instrumentation, the addition of the guitar and the harmonica into the blues was more of a white European aspect than it was an African American aspect. And this is going to be part of your answer to number four, where it says name one type of music that influenced the blues. Well, there's a lot. It was influenced by work songs and field hollers, which were things that were sung during slavery, and minstrel show music, which was performances that were more degrading towards the African-American community, people in blackface, that kind of a thing. But it does take influences from that type of music, from ragtime, from church music, from folk and pop, from the white population. It comes from a lot of different places, and it all kind of comes together in what we now know as like the modern version of the blues. It was mostly performed when it started by Southern black men, which is very similar to what we know about jazz music. Which makes sense because blues is actually very closely related to jazz, and it developed around a similar time, so they've got a lot of similar characteristics. And I'm going to play for you, and it's going to be your answer to number five, a recording of one of the very first blues songs that was ever published. And the name of that song, you can go ahead and put down for your answer to number five, is Memphis Blues. And it was performed by a black, or written by a black band leader named W.C. Handy. So Memphis Blues, and I'm not going to play you the whole thing, I'm just going to play you a little bit of it. So that's quite different from the examples that we just listened to of the more modern version of the blues. The feel is just overall, there's a lot of differences. And you can kind of hear from that, just because this is one of the first blues songs ever released, that like it's clearly developed a lot from like the early 1900s until the 1960s, and kind of gained some new like characteristics as it went along. And again, the name of that song is the Memphis Blues, as your answer to number 5. So a little bit more about the genre in general. Like I said, it was very closely related to jazz. It developed around a similar time and amongst a predominantly black community. So it had a lot of similar characteristics. And the genre changed a lot, actually, during the Great Depression. In case you don't remember, the Great Depression was during the 1930s. So we're talking about the blues and jazz developing towards the end of the 1800s, beginning of 1900s, and then changing a lot during the Great Depression. It became a little bit more urban, and it usually, after that point, developed or included a harmonica or a piano player and a bass or drums in the rhythm section kind of a thing. So it didn't used to have those things, and then post-Great Depression started to add in some other instruments and branch out a little bit more. And like I said, blues heavily influenced rock music, and you'll be able to hear how similar they are once we kind of get into rock and roll a little bit later. But blues definitely had a very strong influence on rock music, which is why we can listen to some of those songs they played for you earlier and say, well, it's a blues song, but it's also rock and roll, because they're incredibly closely related, because a lot of the characteristics of rock and roll actually came from the blues. So let's talk about what makes it a blues song. This will be a little bit challenging to understand because we haven't really talked about chords or anything, but I'll explain as best I can. The blues tends to have what we hear as an AAB section. We like to name sections of songs with letters. So anything that you would name an A section would have like similar notes, but the words would be different. So like the first A section would have a set of words and have a specific set of notes. The next A section would have the same set of notes, but different words. And then the B section would sound different from both the first two A sections. It would have different words and different notes. So the blues takes on that kind of type of repetition. I already talked about this, the structure called the 12-bar blues. So 12 bars is referring to like measures. So we're talking about there's a form in which there's 12 measures at a time and specific chords happen within those measures. We call that 12-bar blues. So I'm not going to go through like a whole chords explanation because that can get pretty complicated, but I will tell you, and this is kind of separated into sections, and I'll play you an example so you can hear what I'm talking about. But we've got like a set of measures, 1, 2, 3, 4, that all end up being the same chord. So pretend like that might be what we call like a C chord for 4 measures in a row, or 4 like sets of measures in a row. And then for measures 5, 6, down there we would have a different chord. We would maybe have an F chord being played for those two measures or for those two sets of measures. And then it goes back to C chord. It would go back to the original one for measure 7 and 8, or sets of measure 7 and 8. And then for measures 9 and 10, we would have a G chord. And then for 11 and 12, we would go back to a C chord. So it doesn't necessarily have to be those letters. It can be different within whatever key we're in or whatever, but you are going to hear the separation of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, etc. until you get to the end. You're going to hear that separation of measures, and I'll play you a little bit of Johnny B. Goode, where that happens, and then I'll kind of break it down, and then I'll play it one more time so you can hear what I'm talking about. So here's a little bit of Johnny B. Goode. It starts after the intro, like right where the lyrics come in, is where the 12-bar form actually starts. Deep down in Louisiana. So that's where the 12-bar blues is, and I'm going to explain it a little bit, and then I'll play it one more time. So what you should have heard, and what you can kind of see me doing, is you're hearing the chord changes. So it's going 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So you can hear kind of those separations in those chord changes. I'm gonna play it one more time. I'm still gonna do the finger thing so you can kind of hear when the changes are. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So that's 12-bar blues. You can kind of hear the separation of those when those chord changes actually happen. And there's different versions of the 12-bar blues, but that's the main one that we talk about. That was like the original version of the 12-bar blues. And that's one of the characteristics that if you would like to go ahead and fill in your answer to number six says describe one characteristic of the blues. We are going to talk about a couple of more, but the first one would be the form. You would say it's in AAB form, and you usually hear it in 12-bar blues form. The next characteristic we talk about is the content, like the lyrical content of the blues. A lot of times it's expressing feelings of sadness over lost love or other life experiences. Johnny B. Goode doesn't necessarily talk about that. But one of these other ones that we're going to listen to will, and I'll kind of point that out to you a little bit later. But a lot of them are a little slower than what we just listened to. They're more like jazz and like a croony type of thing. And they're talking about feelings of sadness or lost love. So for number six, another characteristic that you could say is the lyrical content. The lyrical content of the songs. And then the last one I want to talk about is pitch. There's just a couple of things that we talk about with pitch in the blues that are very characteristic of this genre. And that the first one is melisma. And melisma is the more like music degree way that we would talk about the word riffing. So riffing meaning it's the same word but multiple notes on that word. So you've heard a lot of artists, a lot of modern artists do that kind of a thing, but that actually comes mostly from the blues. The other thing would be pitch bending, meaning instead of singing just initially one note, I might like scoop my way into that note for like dramatic effect or to like really get an emotion across in the song. So I'm gonna show you an example a little bit later of those kinds of things so you can hear what I'm talking about. But that would be your final characteristic you could put for number six, would be melisma, riffing, pitch bending, any of those things you could put for number six. So before I give you an example of what we're talking about with those last two characteristics, with content and with pitch, I want to just quickly remind us, what is cultural appropriation? So think about what you remember from what we talked about when we discussed cultural appropriation. Now see if you remember what it means. Or if you have any initial like emotional connotations or reactions to the phrase. And number seven is where you're going to say, as a reminder, what is cultural appropriation? And a shorter definition than what we discussed the other day would be copying elements of another culture and passing them off as your own. It's usually a dominant culture appropriating from a marginalized culture, and usually the marginalized culture is not receiving credit for the cultural elements that are being copied. So you're welcome to shorten that in any way that you would like and put that for number seven, copying elements of another culture and passing them off as your own. Usually a dominant culture is appropriating from a minority or marginalized culture, and usually that minority culture is not getting credit for the cultural elements. So we're going to talk about appropriation in the blues. So you've probably heard the version of Hound Dog that I just played, the Elvis Presley version of Hound Dog. He was not the first person to perform that song, and in fact, it was not written for him. Not that people can't sing songs that were written for other people because covers are really popular and a lot of times they're really great. But you always have to give credit to the person who originally performed it, especially if you are going to be the one profiting off of it. So the first person to perform Hound Dog was actually a black singer from Alabama named Big Mama Thornton. And her version is very different from the Elvis version. So number 8 says, describe a difference between the Elvis recording and the Big Mama Thornton recording of Hound Dog. So I'm going to play you a little bit of the Elvis one, and then I'm going to play you the whole version of the Big Mama Thornton one. So here's a little bit more of the Elvis version. All right, so now I'm going to play you the full version of the Big Mama Thornton performance. And I am going to video screen share for this one as well, because this is actually a live performance of this song. So again, think about the differences, the musical differences that you are hearing between the Elvis version and this version by the original performer, Big Mama Thornton. So that is the original version of Hound Dog. So go ahead and come up with a few differences if you can, and write at least one for number 8. Describe a difference between the Elvis recording and the Big Mama Thornton recording of Hound Dog. You can already tell just in that recording, from the couple of blues characteristics that we just talked about, that song is definitely more in the blues vein, and then the Elvis version is way more into the rock and roll vein, which, like, is fine, because songs should evolve, and, like, musical genres should evolve and stuff like that. But the people who originally performed songs should always receive credit for their work, which evidently did not happen for Mama Thornton for a lot of years. But so, in that song, we talked about that the Elvis version, the lyrical content is not really about expressing feelings of sadness or anything over, like, lost love. It's, you ain't nothing but a hound dog crying all the time, you ain't never caught a rabbit, you ain't no friend of mine. I do not know what that means. And, like, you should be able to sing songs about stuff that are just fun and mean nothing, but just in relation to this original version, I do not know what those lyrics mean. The Big Mama Thornton lyrics are different. So she's, some of them are similar and some of them are a completely different song meaning. So, you ain't nothing but a hound dog, been snooping around the door. You can wag your tail, I ain't gonna feed you no more. You told me you was high class, but I could see through that. You ain't no real cool cat. This is a song about a woman, like, realizing that her partner is no good for her and, like, kicking him out. So, it's different. And this one's more about lost love, like, when we're talking about in, like, blues characteristics. The other thing is, Big Mama Thornton is incredible at the melisma riffing type thing and at the pitch bending thing. She also does a lot of, like, spoken words or, like, almost shouted words to kind of add her own, like, character and flavor into the song. And I'm sure a lot of that is not the same every time. I'm sure a lot of that is improvisation, just like we talked about with jazz. So it's just, it's very full of her personality when she's adding in the riffing and the pitch bending and all of those things. It's just very impressive, and it's incredibly unique the way that she performs it. So hopefully you were able to write down some differences for number 8 between the Elvis recording and the Big Mama Thornton recording. So for number 9 says, do you think Elvis culturally appropriated Hound Dog? Why or why not? And I would like for that to be, again, completely your opinion, like we've talked about before. There's not a right or wrong answer. We've talked about that, like, even though Big Mama Thornton didn't technically own the song, like, the copyright company owns the song, there are still some other factors at play. So I want to, like, tell you a little story, about the song. So there are two, Jewish American men who actually wrote the song Hound Dog for Big Mama Thornton. And they specifically wanted to write it for her because they knew the way that she would perform it would be incredible. It would be like the performance that we just heard, with her, like, belting it and growling it and all that stuff. So they wrote it with a lot of specific characteristics in mind. So one of those Jewish American men, his last name is Stoller, and then the other guy's last name is Lieber. So that's who we're talking about in this little story. So this is directly from Wikipedia. While Elvis Presley was performing Hound Dog on television and his record was scaling the charts, Stoller, who had been on vacation in Europe, was returning on the ill-fated final voyage of the Andrea Doria. So he's coming back from Europe. On July 26, 1956, Lieber, so the other Jewish-American writer, met the just-rescued Stoller on the docks and told him, we got a smash hit on Hound Dog, because this is when Elvis's version is getting really popular. Stoller said, Big Mama's record? And Lieber replied, no, some white guy named Elvis Presley. Stoller added, and I heard the record and I was disappointed. It just sounded terribly nervous, too fast, too white. But you know, after it sold 7 or 8 million records, it started to sound better. And I don't know if there's a better description of what it looks like for something to be culturally appropriated than for the black community to develop the genre of the blues, for a black woman, an incredibly talented black woman, to sing the heck out of this song and not get credit for it and not make a lot of money off of it, and then for a white male singer to take the song and sing it in a completely different way, maybe not completely different, sing it in a few different ways, and make a lot more money off of it, and for it to sound like almost a different song. So again, I would like for you to answer number 9 with your own opinion. Do you think Elvis culturally appropriated Hound Dog? We've talked about that cultural appropriation also has to do with the context of the release of things like this. And I have tried to find information as to whether Elvis like tried to credit Big Mama Thornton or if he talked about where his inspiration came from. I haven't been able to find anything that says that he did, and I've been searching for that. So it does look like the release of this song was very much like I did this. I performed it. So again, take with that what you will. I would like to hear your opinion. So question here, and this could be your answer to number 10. Does this mean white people can't sing the blues? This is number 10. Do you think members of non-black cultures can perform the blues without culturally appropriating? And why or why not? Why do you feel that way? Because we've talked about there's a possibility that like the way that you perform something and the way that you present it can be very respectful and can be really thoughtful and celebratory of cultures, especially when like the blues specifically was developed in black communities, that kind of a thing. And so that's going to be your answer number 10. Go ahead and start thinking about your answer. Just like a little bit more history about the blues to kind of keep in mind when you're thinking about your answer. So the genre, I've already said this, the genre has ties to more than one race. It was mainly developed in black communities. It was dominated by black musicians before white musicians also started performing the blues. But like the development of it does have ties to like I said, West African musical traits and then also European musical traits. So the history is pretty complicated. There are some early blues artists, early white blues artists, like Monroe Mo Jackson, Harmonica Frank, Jimmy Rogers were like early white blues artists who are also very good and who were kind of participating in the development of the genre. So it's not like only black communities were developing around that time. And actually, this is kind of some interesting, like, confusing history. Commercial recordings started to be more common around, like, the mid-20th century, so the middle of the 1900s. And they started labeling when this happened, when you started hearing recordings of songs on the radio more often, they started labeling black blues artists as race or blues music, like the word race or the word blues music. And then they would label white blues artists as country or hillbilly music. But it was actually the same type of music. They just decided they were going to call the white version something else. But the music was so similar that sometimes they actually got it wrong. So, for example, the record company Columbia released a recording by the Allen Brothers, and they called it race music, and the Allen Brothers were actually white, and that was wrong. But they didn't know that because it sounds so similar, because at that point in time, like country music or hillbilly music in the way that we think about it today did not sound like the way that we think about it today. It actually was just blues music, but performed by white artists. And for some reason, recording companies thought it was important for people to know when they were listening to the radio, whether or not they were listening to a white artist or a blues artist. So there's a lot of complicated history in the blues. And that's why we take some more time to kind of think about. Is it possible for members of non-black cultures to perform the blues without culturally appropriating? So again, I'm not going to push my own opinion onto your answer. I would love to hear what you think about it based on the information as presented for number 10. So what do you think? And once you're done with that, you are welcome to go ahead and check over your answers and then submit on your assignment.